Coshocton, Ohio. If you are visiting with us this morning, we are so glad that you have come. May you experience God's love that is here for you. Happy birthday this week to Melissa Kilcherman, Janet Luce, Corey McPack, Carol Henderson, Scott Slagle, Stephen Slagle, Steve Slagle, Judy Cox, Chris Franklin, Vicki Skernis, Shirley Weaver, Cindy Albertson, Pam Baker, Gladys Ricketts, Deborah Taylor, and Cooper Wood. Phew, that was a long list. How'd I do, everybody? You can tell me later who I mispronounced. Are there any other birthdays or anniversaries this week? Okay. Members are invited to an annual meeting of the congregation and corporation on Sunday, February 27th, in the fellowship hall, following worship and following a meal. You don't have to be a member of the congregation to join us in the fellowship meal. We are having a Lenten program beginning Ash Wednesday that will start with a meal at 5:30. Different groups will be preparing that light meal, and we'll have a study at 6:30. We will have a separate program for children as well as adults, two programs going on, same theme for both programs, same ideas, maybe even watching the same video clips together. The theme is the way, walking in the footsteps of Jesus. Let's take a moment and share some joys and concerns with one another. Lance Folks is recovering from surgery to remove a brain tumor. Please hold him in your prayers. This is a bit of a recovery for him. And he thanks all of us for our prayers and our encouragement. Now I invite you, what do you have to share with your church family? Yes, Carly. I'm enjoying watching those posts too, that helps. We'll continue to pray for Annie, who did have her liver transplant the day after her birthday. What a present. No. Others, you want to share? Yes, Margaret? Debbie, you'll have to model that your boot has been removed. We're glad you're healing. Anything else, Margaret? No. Anyone else? Let us worship our risen Lord.
Please join me in the opening sentences. God asked, "Whom shall I send?"
Here I am.
Jesus says, "Follow me and share in my work." The Holy Spirit gathers each one of us for worship.
Here we are to worship God.
Let us pray. Holy One, by your grace, we are your own. Stir in us the desire to follow you, that your grace toward us may not be in vain, but may become our motivation to go where you send us. Amen.
confess our sin, confident in God's faithful and steadfast love for us. Please join me in the prayer of confession. O God, though we walk in the midst of trouble, you preserve and deliver us. Forgive us, we pray, when we wander away from you, lost and at risk. Forgive us when our lives do not reflect your glory and the purposes you intend. Help us to comprehend your ways in the world. We long to feel your grace and glory. For in you, Emmanuel, we can be healed and set free. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Jesus Christ is risen from the dead. Not even death can separate us from God's love. This is good news. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
Spectators too. watch everything, they look at everything, they see everything, but they don't do anything. And you know some people that are spectators, they just sit back and watch and they don't do anything. All right, I don't think that's what God wants for you and I. He wants to have something better in mind than that, okay? Let's see. Now, oh, this one is special. That's a sweet tater. And I think that's what God wants us to be. God wants us to be sweet and kind and loving and generous and respectful. Be respectful to your mom and dad. Be respectful to your teachers. Be respectful to your brothers and sisters. I know that's hard sometimes. But that's what God wants for us. And if you do that, you'll be doing God's will. Let's pray. Father in heaven, help us to be sweet, kind, gentle, loving, and respectful always. And help us this day, bless us, and keep us safe from harm. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. Thank you very much. Oh, I have something for you. You can thank Pastor Karen for this. I was just going to give you a tater tot.
With authority.
Thanks be to God.
Jesus was standing beside the lake of Gennesaret, and the crowd was pressing in on him to hear the word of God. He saw two boats there at the shore of the lake. The fishermen had gone out of them and were washing their nets. He got into one of the boats, the one belonging to Simon, and asked him to put out a little way from the shore. Then he sat down and taught the crowds from the boat. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, "Put out into the deep water and let down your nets for a catch." Simon answered, "Master, we have worked all night long, but have caught nothing. Yet, if you say so, I will let down the nets." When they had done this, they caught so many fish that their nets were beginning to break.
So they signal their partners in the other boat to come and help them. And they came and filled both boats so that they began to sink. But when Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, "Go away from me, Lord, for I am a sinful man." For he and all who were with him were amazed at the catch of fish that they had taken. And so also were James and John, sons of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon. Then Jesus said to Simon, "Do not be afraid. From now on, you will be catching people." When they had brought their boats to shore, they left everything and followed him. Holy wisdom, holy word, thanks be to God. I was sorry that we had to cancel worship last Sunday. Wasn't that weird? Because of ice. It was really dangerous out there. Took your life in your hands just trying to get the mail. Anybody have a slip or a little fall?
I did.
Yeah, it was crazy. But honestly, wasn't it a relief that we weren't canceling because of the pandemic? Weren't we relieved? Hey, we're getting back to normal. It feels like we are getting back to ministry as usual in winter in Ohio. Amen. Today is the Super Bowl. Is that news to any of you guys? You guys knew that up there? Yeah. Got any Super Bowl fans in here? People that like to watch the Super Bowl? Maybe. Yeah. Who's rooting for the Cincinnati Bengals? Okay. Got some Tiger lovers here. How about the Los Angeles Rams? So now that you've seen everyone else who's on the other side, go ahead, slip up your hands. How many of you are just going to watch it for the commercials? Aren't the commercials great? Just love them. Or maybe the halftime show. Well, I'm in Ohio now, so I don't usually care about football, but I'm going to be rooting for the Bengals because I'm in Ohio now. Even people who don't care about football were talking about their comeback from a 21-3 deficit to unseat the Kansas City Chiefs at the AFC Championship on January 30th. Anyone here watch that game? I happened to see it. We were like, "Oh yeah, the game's over." How many of you thought, "Oh, the game's over, and this is really sad"? And it's like, "Oh, what just happened?" Right? That was quite a game. I read this week about the Bengals quarterback, Joe Burrow, and his family's passion for sports. Joe was born in Ames, Iowa, when his father, Jim, was on the staff for the Iowa State Cyclones. Here's him as a little tyke. He was getting ready for football even back then. His dad, Jim, was a football player and coach whose career spanned over 40 years. Joe's grandmother in the 40s, I read, set a Mississippi State high school record with an 82-point game in basketball. 82 points. I didn't have pictures of his paternal grandfather, but his paternal grandfather played basketball at Mississippi State. His uncle John played football at Ole Miss, and two older brothers also played football at Nebraska. Little Joe Burrow attended the 2002 Rose Bowl when he was 5 years old. His father was assistant coach then for Nebraska. Not long after, he began playing in youth football. We've got a few here that are playing in youth football. Raise your hand if you're still doing some football. Absolutely. He started out as a quarterback, and this is why. Because his first youth team had no one else to play that position. That's how he got started, with quarterback. He ended up in Athens, Ohio, when his father accepted the defensive coordinator position at Ohio University in Athens. Joe played football at Athens High, leading the school to 3 straight playoff appearances and the school's first 7 playoff victories in school history. He won a pile of awards, and the school board decided in 2019 to name the school's football stadium in his honor. Joe played college football for Ohio State, got a few Ohio State fans. Then LSU. He won the Heisman Trophy and the 2020 College Football Playoff National Championship as a senior. You could say that Joe's entire life up to this moment was taking him on a certain path to become the professional football player that he is today. I just like all those stripes and the whole cat thing going on. Today in worship, we're going to recognize a different kind of greatness. Amen? A greatness of service to God. We will welcome and pray for our new team of leaders as we ordain and install elders and deacons. As we seek God's blessing upon everyone who said yes to the call of Jesus Christ, we honor and give thanks for the great cloud of witnesses, those who have given us the faithful example of service to the Lord and His church. We wouldn't be where we are today if it hadn't been for the great cloud of witnesses. We look to the future and we keep moving forward with our eyes fixed on Jesus, praying for healing, peace, and reconciliation after 2 difficult years of a pandemic. Has it been difficult years? 2 years of a pandemic. Praying for peace, praying for healing, reconciliation. We say yes to serving because we love and we trust the Lord, and we love our brothers and sisters in Christ, and we believe in this ministry. Say that with me now. I believe in this ministry. We believe in this ministry. We are not just a human organization. We are not some kind of Presbyterian Christian club, are we? No, we are not that. We are an incarnational ministry. You heard that word before, incarnational. This is what it means. Serving as Christ's hands and feet, mind and heart. We are Jesus for people. We are. And we gotta be together to do that. Amen. 2 difficult years of a pandemic. We remember the call of the first disciples in our gospel reading today in Luke to encourage and enlighten us as we say yes, all of us, yes, once again, to our own call to live as Christ's disciples and make disciples of all the generations. This is our call. This is it. Our reading in Luke marks a significant moment in Christ's ministry. Significant. But it's not the beginning of the story. I want to make sure you know that. His disciples are not strangers to him when he calls them. Oh, no. An interesting detail in Luke, not found in other Gospels. Look at 3:23. Jesus was about 30 years old when he began his work. 30. The first 30 years of his life was all preparation. Preparation for what God wanted him to do. 30 years of age. After his birth, baptism, and temptation, Jesus traveled. He preached, he healed, he cast out demons. Reports of his miracles spread all around the region. He was a rock star. Then one day, after he preaches in the synagogue in Capernaum. It didn't go well that day, but you know the story. Jesus goes to Simon's house. He had stayed in Simon's house before. And what did he do while he was there? He heals Simon's mother-in-law. She's in bed with a fever. He healed her. The demons proclaim what human beings had not yet said. This is what the demons say. You are the Son of God. At daybreak, Jesus tries to get away from the crowd. He tries and he can't get away from them. But then he goes to a deserted place. Maybe he went to pray, but it doesn't say that. I don't think it is. I think he needed to rest, and he needed some peace and quiet just to get ready for this work of ministry. When the crowds cling to him on his return and demand more miracles, he says, I gotta go. I must proclaim the good news of the kingdom of God to the other cities also, for I was sent for this purpose. He goes and he preaches in synagogues all over Judea. And then we come to today's passage. Here we go. Chapter 5. Jesus is standing on the shore of the Lake of Gennesaret, also known as the Sea of Tiberias, or Sea of Galilee. That might sound more familiar to you. The crowd is pressing in. Jesus needs a pulpit. What do you think of Jesus' pulpit? He uses a boat. Can we work that out here? Can I have a boat for my pulpit? Can sure. You build me a boat?
Sure.
Thanks, Matt. And he asked Simon, okay, he picked already Simon out, this was Simon's job, to take the boat a little way from the shore. It looks something like this. Yeah. Because, you know, back then they sat down while they taught and preached. They sat down. He's in the boat. He finishes his sermon. We have no idea what it was about. And he asked, because this is what the real sermon is, he asked Simon to take the boat out into the deep water. This is the sermon. And let down his nets for a catch. Simon's tired. His body is aching from the physical labor of fishing in the first century. It was hard, exhausting work. And he's even more tired because they were unsuccessful. I'm looking at you guys. When you're fishing all day and you catch nothing, you're tired, aren't you? Yeah. That's how it was with him. All night. And this is his occupation. If he doesn't have fish, they don't eat, they don't pay their bills. He's tired. It's a big waste of time and energy. That's what he's thinking. Maybe he's thinking, I need to go to a recruiter and get a real job. No, he wasn't thinking that. I wonder, is he saying yes to Christ's request more out of obligation? Because he healed his mother-in-law. He stayed in his home. For you, I will do it. His address as master reveals his respect for him, but then the next part says the opposite, that Jesus doesn't know a thing about fishing. He probably didn't. His dad was what? A carpenter. Or else he wouldn't ask Simon to go back out. Master, we have worked all night long, but caught nothing, Simon says. Yet if you say so, I will let down the net. When my husband says, if you say so to me, do you all have a husband who sometimes says, if you say so? What does it really mean? He thinks I'm wrong. Immediately they catch so many fish, the nets are breaking. This never happens. This is the biggest catch they've ever had. They call in their partners, Simon's partners, James and John, sons of Zebedee, come and help them. But their technology fails them. Their boats begin to sink. And Simon at that moment realizes that Christ has done this miracle to reveal his power and deal with Simon's own unbelief. This is what this is all about. Go away from me, for I'm a sinful man, he says. He's convicted, he's ashamed, he falls at Jesus' knees, and Jesus responds with grace, just like he responds to us always with grace. He says, don't be afraid. This is an echo of the Lord reassuring Isaiah at his calling when Isaiah confesses, what does he say? To be a man of unclean lips, living in a land of unclean lips. And then the best part of the story, and then you know what the best part of the story is for me? This is it. This is it. They bring their boats back to shore, and they leave everything behind to follow him. They quit their job, they left their stuff, they leave everything behind to follow him. I get goosebumps at that part in the story. Simon isn't a youngster at this time when he makes this life-changing decision. He's not a youngster. He has a wife, an extended family living with him. He has a house. He has a good, steady job. He has his own fishing boat, own business. He has a life, a predictable routine, until he meets Jesus. It's not really a question, this invitation. It's not like in Isaiah when God asks, whom shall I send? And who will go for us? Oh no, it's a statement. Do not be afraid, Jesus says to Simon, James, and John. From now on, you will be catching people. Friends, those who take Christ's service seriously, realizing that it is a life-changing thing, just like it was for Simon Peter, come to this moment with fear and trembling, fear and trembling. Our leadership example is Jesus Christ, who came not to serve, not to be served, but to serve, and give his life as a ransom for me. That's better. And there's something important I want you to remember. The leaders we are seeking to bless today with our love, with our prayerful support, these leaders, they aren't meant to be the Church of Jesus Christ for us. They're not going to be the church for us. That's not their job. They are meant to help us. Help us to be the church that God wants us to be. And your call, my friends, is not a one-time thing. Although this particular day, the life of Simon Peter will be remembered and retold for centuries after the crucifixion, resurrection, an empty tomb. Recalling this joyful story serves to empower the grieving disciples when they have to figure out how they will go on with Christ's ministry when he's no longer with them in the flesh. This is what gets them going. This is it. This joyful story, the call of Simon, is necessary for all of us. For everyone who answers the call, but then grows weary or frightened. Anyone in here serving as an elder or deacon ever grow weary? Ever grow weary? Ever go weary? Ever get frightened? Oh no, I'm not worthy of this. I can't do this. This is too much. Ever get frightened? This story is for you. When the call gets hard, because it always gets hard, doesn't it, Mary Alice? It gets hard. It does. It does. Jesus invites us now to trust and obey him no matter how weary or how long we worked the day or night before without seeing the fruits of our labor, because that happens. We don't always see the fruits of our labor.
Jesus urges us to persevere with his help for his sake. Do not be afraid, he says to all of us. Put out into the deep water. Let down your nets for a catch. Let us pray. Holy One, thank you for your word, for the stories of the calls of Simon Peter and Isaiah. Your word continues to encourage us and illumine our call to be your disciples and to make disciples right here in our own community of faith and beyond our church walls. Lord, we say yes to your invitation with fear and trembling. We know that serving you will take all of ourselves, who we are now and who we will become as your Spirit works in us and in our midst. We grow weary sometimes, Lord. We feel frustrated or discouraged when we don't see immediate fruits of our labor. Help us to trust in you and obey, following Christ step by step. And bless our congregation, especially our newly ordained and installed, who seek to serve you with their lives. Teach us how to support, encourage, and join with them in loving service to one another and the world. May we become in all that we say and do your hands and feet, heart and mind. In Christ's name we pray.
Thank you.
door installed, to come on up to the chancel. If you have a mask, we invite you to wear it. Come on up. Come this soda. Spread out. Come on up. Thought we have more room up above. Don't leave your other brothers and sisters in Christ. We're all here together. Yep. Come on. There are varieties of gifts, but it is the same Spirit who gives them. There are different ways of serving God, but it is the same Lord who is served. God works through each person in a unique way, but it is God's purpose that is accomplished. To each is given a gift of the Spirit to be used for the common good. Together we are the body of Christ, and individually members. Amen. We are all called into the Church of Jesus Christ by baptism, and marked as Christ's own by the Holy Spirit. This is our common calling, to be disciples of Jesus Christ and servants of our servant Lord. Within the community of the church, some are called to particular service as deacons, as ruling elders, and as ministers of word and sacrament. Ordination is Christ's gift to the church, assuring that his ministry continues among us. Through ordination, God provides for acts of care and compassion in the world, for the ordering and governance of the church, and for the preaching of the word and celebration of the sacraments.
Representing the one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church, the session of the Presbyterian Church of Coshocton now ordains Nancy Cox and Linda Weber to ministry as ruling elders, and Norma Brewing to ministry as a deacon, and installs them to active service in this congregation. The session also installs to active service those who have previously been ordained: Deacon Cindy Walling and ruling elders Kirsten Peck, Don Harrison, and Lauren Fry.
As God calls some to particular forms of ministry, God calls us all to bear gladly the yoke of Christ given in the covenant of baptism. Let us therefore reaffirm our baptismal vows, renouncing all that opposes God and God's rule, and affirming the faith of the Holy Catholic Church. Trusting in the gracious mercy of God, do you turn from the ways of sin and renounce evil and its power in the world? And so say, I do. Do you turn to Jesus Christ and accept him as your Lord and Savior, trusting in his grace and love? If so say, I do. Will you be Christ's faithful disciple, obeying his word and showing his love? If so, say, I will, with God's help.
I will, with your God's help.
With the whole church, let us confess our faith. I invite those who are able to stand. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. Let us pray. Gracious and eternal God, with joy we give you thanks and praise. We praise you for leading your people Israel through the waters of the sea, out of bondage and into freedom in the land of your promise. We praise you for sending Jesus, your Son, who for us was baptized in the waters of the Jordan and was anointed as the Christ by your Holy Spirit. Through the baptism of his death and resurrection, you set us free from the bondage of sin and death and give us cleansing and rebirth. We praise you for pouring out your Holy Spirit, who teaches us and leads us into all truth, filling us with a variety of gifts that we might proclaim the gospel to all nations and serve you as a royal priesthood. We rejoice that you have claimed us in our baptism and anointed us for service in Christ's name, and that by your grace we are born anew. By your Holy Spirit, renew us, that we may be empowered to do your will and continue forever in the risen life of Christ, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all glory and honor, now and forever. Amen. Friends, remember your baptism and be thankful. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Okay, you're not in the ordering, Michael, here, so we'll just flow with it. Okay. So if I look at the wrong person, don't go back. Nancy, Linda, Norma, Cindy, Kirsten, Don, and Lauren at home today. In baptism, you were claimed by the love of God, clothed in the grace of Jesus Christ, and anointed with the gifts of the Holy Spirit to share Christ's mission in the world. Now you are called by God through the voice of the church for a new service and ministry in Jesus' name. In accordance with the Constitution of the Presbyterian Church, USA, show your commitment to these calling, to this calling, by responding to these questions. Do you trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, your Savior? Acknowledge him, Lord of all, and head of the church, and through him believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. If so, say, I do. Do you accept the scriptures of the Old and New Testaments to be by the Holy Spirit the unique and authoritative witness to Jesus Christ in the church universal and God's word to you? If so, say, I do. Do you sincerely receive and adopt the essential tenets of the Reformed faith as expressed in the confessions of our church as authentic and reliable expositions of what Scripture leads us to believe and do? And will you be instructed and led by these confessions as you lead the people of God? If so, please say, I do and I will. Will you fulfill your ministry in obedience to Jesus Christ under the authority of Scripture and be continually guided by our confessions? If so, say, I will. Will you be governed by our church's polity? And will you abide by its discipline? Will you be a friend among your colleagues in ministry, working with them, subject to the ordering of God's word and spirit? If so, say, I will. Will you in your own life seek to follow Jesus Christ, love your neighbors, and work for the reconciliation of the world? If so, say, I will. Do you promise to further the peace, unity, and purity of the church If so, say, I do.
I do.
Will you pray for and seek to serve the people with energy, intelligence, imagination, and love? If so, please say, I love. This question is for our deacons, Norma and Cindy. Will you be a faithful deacon, teaching charity, urging concern, and directing the people's help to the friendless and those in need? And in your ministry, will you try to show the love and justice of Jesus Christ? If so, please say, I will. Now for ruling elders. Will you be a faithful ruling elder, watching over the people, providing for their worship, nurture, and service? Will you share in government and discipline, serving in councils of the church? And in your ministry, will you try to show the love and justice of Jesus Christ? If so, please say, I will.
These questions are for the congregation. Do we, the members of the church, except Nancy, Linda, Kirsten, Don, Lauren, Norma, and Cindy, as ruling elders and deacons chosen by God through the voice of this congregation to lead us in the way of Jesus Christ? If so, say, we do.
We do.
Do we agree to pray for them, to encourage them, to respect their decisions, and to follow as they guide us, serving Jesus Christ, who alone is the head of the church? If so, say, we do.
We do.
And now we're going to pray. And my book says that you have to kneel, and I have to lay hands on you. We are not going to kneel. Okay? And today, I don't want us to have to touch one another if we're, you know, not feeling comfortable with that. But maybe we'll just put out our hands. And folks, you back there, will you put your hands out as if you are praying for the anointing of these folks? Let us pray. Gracious and eternal God, with joy we give you thanks and praise. Throughout the ages and in every place, you have chosen servants from among your people to point the way to salvation by your grace. We are grateful for ancestors in the faith who followed without fear, placing their trust in you alone, for judges and monarchs who ruled in righteousness and peace, for prophets and apostles who spoke your bold words of mercy and of truth, for leaders and teachers in every age who have nurtured your people in faith and faithfulness. Above all, we praise you for Jesus Christ, who came not to be served, but to serve and to give his life to set others free. Anointed by your Holy Spirit, he proclaimed your reign on earth, revealing your saving love in all he said and did. Gracious God, pour out your Spirit upon your servants, Nancy, Linda, and Norma, whom you called by baptism as your own. Grant them the same mind that was in Christ Jesus. Gracious God, we also give you thanks for your servants, Kirsten, Don, Lauren, and Cindy, as they continue in the ministry to which you have called them. Help them to rely on the gifts of your Spirit and to follow Christ faithfully in this calling. Give them a spirit of truthfulness, that they may show the compassion of Christ in the actions of daily living and rightly govern your people. Gracious God, pour out your Spirit of power and truth upon the whole church, that we may be for you a holy people, baptized to serve you in the world. Sustain your church and ministry. Ground us in the gospel. Secure our hope in Christ. Strengthen our service to the outcast and increase our love for one another. Show us the transforming power of your grace in our life together, that we may be effective servants of the gospel, offering a compelling witness in the world to the good news of Christ Jesus, our Lord. Amen. Norma, you are a deacon. And Nancy and Linda, you are ruling elders, ordained to ministries of service and governance in the Church of Jesus Christ and for this congregation. Be faithful and true in your ministry so that your whole life will bear witness to the crucified and risen Christ. Let us welcome the newly ordained and installed. Jim has a certificate for you, and after you take that, you may go back to your seats. Thank you so much for coming up and for saying yes to the call of Jesus Christ. Thank you. Thank you, Jim. Like the disciples whose nets were beginning to break with the abundance of fish, we are overwhelmed with gratitude as we see Christ in our world in this season. Let us return a portion of the gifts that God has given us.
Thank you.
afraid to go out into the deep water. We're not alone. We have partners in other boats around us, and Christ has gone before us. Let down your nets, expecting God's abundant provision. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.